Joining us for this service. For those of you who are with us this morning, thank you for coming back. I hope you were blessed. And for those of you who didn't join us this morning, feel free to go watch the video, but also thank you for joining us for another service. This evening, we have an amazing and spirit-filled program lined up that you will not only be enriched in your soul, but be able to go back down memory lane as we highlight the 80s. So get comfortable and get ready to be blessed.
Toronto Perth SDA Church. Wow, 50 years. I just want to say happy anniversary. Congratulations on making it this far in your ministry. I personally want to thank you for your support over the years. I remember attending Perth. You guys were my first church. My mom and I attended when I was 4, and you took us in as family. You supported us, and I know that I am who I am today because of you. So thank you so much for everything, and I pray that your ministry will continue to grow and that you will continue to let God lead your church. So with that being said, let's get into the AY mission, aim, motto, and pledge. The AY mission, the salvation of youth through Jesus Christ. We understand youth ministry to be that work of the church that is conducted for, with, and by young people. The AY aim, the Advent message to all the world in my generation. The AY motto, the love of Christ compels me. The AY pledge, loving the Lord Jesus, I promise to take an active part in the youth ministry of the church, doing what I can to help others and to finish the work of the gospel in all the world.
Adventist youth are we, from every land and sea. Together we pray, we work and play in happy harmony. We have a faith to share with others everywhere. A message of love from God above to show the world we care. Adventist youth, Adventist youth are we, from every land and sea. Together we pray, we work and play in happy harmony. We have a faith to share with others everywhere. A message of love from God above to show the world we care. Adventist youth, Adventist youth, Adventist youth.
Hello, Perth. The banquet table is set. The food is prepared. Let us celebrate by partaking in the spiritual food that God has prepared for us. This is a blast from the past. 50 years of service to the church community. To God be the glory, great things He has done. On behalf of the Toronto Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church, The privilege is mine to give you a hearty welcome to our church family and friends and those who are visiting us on social media such as Facebook and YouTube. We are here today to celebrate an Adventist youth service going back to the 80s and 90s, reflecting on the goodness of the Lord as we commemorate our church golden jubilee. God has truly been good to us. Let us continue to trust the Lord until He comes. As we go forward, let us relax and enjoy the service from the past. Again, I say welcome. Stay tuned. You will surely be blessed. Let us pray. We come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in His holy word. He never failed us yet. Loving Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We come before you this evening to give you thanks for all that you have done for us. We thank you, O God, for this Sabbath day that you have established from creation, where we come to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we ask you, Lord, to forgive us for all our sins, wash us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and make us more like you. As we come before you, God, we ask, Lord, to be with us during this AY service. Remember the young people, Lord Jesus. I'm asking, Lord, that you will bless them and keep them and anoint them with your Holy Spirit. Help them, oh God, that they will trust you where they cannot trace you. Be with the church at large. Lord, we have made 50 golden jubilee years, and we just want to thank you. Lord, you've been with us in the past, and you promised that you will never leave us nor forsake us, that you will be with us to the end. Continue to bless us and keep us, and help us, oh God, that we will live for you come what may. No matter what is going on in this world, God, we can see that we have something called COVID-19, a pandemic. But through it all, God, we know that you are still in control. Let us put our trust in you. Let us continue to serve you because, God, we know you are coming soon. And help us, oh God, to be ready to go home, to live with you, and reign with you for eternity. In Jesus' name's sake, I say amen and amen.
Good afternoon, Toronto Perth family and visiting friends. Welcome to our AY program this evening. As we continue our 50th anniversary celebration and fellowship together this evening, I invite you to reflect on our humble beginnings and look at how far God has brought us. I pray that as we continue to celebrate the past and embrace the future, that God's grace will abound all the more in this new chapter of our ministry together. God never said that this journey would be easy, but He promised that it would be worthwhile. So thank you for your continued support that not only built a strong foundation, but kept our church through thick and thin. I hope that you are blessed by this afternoon's program. God bless you as we continue to worship God together.
It's amazing what praises can do. Amazing what praises
Happy Sabbath. My name is Nadine Stennett, middle child of Susanna and Dylan Stennett. I am married to Andrew Thomas for almost 21 years with two children, Tanisha and Trevon Thomas. 50 years, wow. I'm not quite 50 as yet, but Perth has been my home since I've been a baby. That is where my sisters, Marcia and Denise, and I grew up, going to Pathfinders and having great leaders like Sister Powell, Sister Maisvis Griffin, Auntie Norma, Gilbert Weeks, and others. In my early teens, I remember going to Pastor Brown, Howard Groves, and I, asking for his help to start a new choir called Divine Word. What an experience I had growing up at 243 Perth Avenue. We grew up with the Mackenzies, Arlene Campbell, the Covers, the Records, the Bernards, the Brooks, the Simpsons, the Weedles, the Bratz, the Weeks. Oh, I could go on. There's so much more. The pastors that played an important part in my life growing up, like Dr. Steve Cassamy, Pastor McFarlane, Pastor Brown, Frankie Lazarus, Pastor Nemhard, Ishmael Ali. He wasn't a pastor at the time, but he is a pastor now, and he also had a major role in my life. There was also Pastor Herlock, who married me in 2000. I could go on. The memories that I have growing up at 243 Perth Avenue, it's been an experience. My dad, Dylan Stennett, was a faithful servant, was a deacon, and he made his way to head deacon. And man, oh man, did he wear that deacon pin with pride. His shoes shining, his suit pressed and ready for every Sabbath morning. Every church needs a Dr. Dylan Stennett. What a man. Ask me his main characters, was discipline, yet all the young people loved him. On time was his goal, cleanliness was next to none. The only member who had a military funeral. 243 Perth Avenue was his second home. His name has been etched in so many members and will never be forgotten. I remember him doing church trips all over the city. The one that most stands out to me, and very close to my heart, is when he planned Emma Griffin's graduation brush trip. He loved the Griffin family. Tony and my dad were best friends. His name, Dylan Stennett, will never be forgotten. We all hope to see him again in the earth made new. He would wake us up bright and early to open church doors, and when sun set and ready to go home, he would be shaking his keys, time to lock up church doors at 243 Perth Avenue. I am so happy that I was able to get married at 243 Perth Avenue, over 20 years now, and have my dad, AKA, I call him Dilly, but that's okay, that's the relationship that we had, walk me down those aisles. Most of my best memories is after AY. And everybody would make a circle in the sanctuary, holding hands. And after prayer, we would sing. Side by side, we sang. Waiting God's command, worshiping the saving King. Living by his grace and moving out in faith. Jesus will see us through. Why don't you meet me in heaven? We'll join hands together. Meet me by the Savior's side. I'll meet you in heaven. We'll sing songs together, brothers and sisters, I'll be there. Soldiers all are we, to go where Jesus leads, to fight the foe that we will overcome. Heaven is my goal, to save every soul. Pray that we all will be there. Cheers to 50 years, 243 Perth Avenue. God bless you all. When we all get to heaven, what a day that will be. God bless you all.
Jesus, you're the center of my joy. And all that's good and perfect comes from you. Yes, it does. And you're the heart of my contentment, the hope for all I do. Oh, Jesus, you're the center of my joy. When I've lost my direction, you're the compass for my way. Lord, you're the fire and the light when my nights are long and cold. In the sadness, you are the laughter that conquers all my fears. And when I'm all alone, your hand is there to hold. Can you help me say, Jesus, you're the center,
you're the center of my joy.
See, all that's good and perfect,
all that's good and perfect comes from you.
Everybody say, you're the heart.
You're the heart of my contentment.
I'm hope for everything that I do.
For all I do.
Sing Jesus.
Jesus.
You're the center.
You're the center of my joy.
Can we sing it one more time? Everybody lift it up. Jesus.
Jesus.
You're the center.
You're the center of my joy.
Yes, you are.
Of my contentment,
content with everything that you
hope
do.
For all I do.
Come on, everybody, help me lift up. Say, hey, Jesus.
Jesus.
Sing, Lord, you are.
You are
the very center.
The center,
center of my joy.
Of my
Jesus.
Joy. Jesus.
Say, Lord, you are.
You are
the center.
The center.
The center of my joy.
Of
say,
my
Jesus.
Joy.
Lord, you are main in my
the
heart,
center
you are main in my soul,
of
when
my
everything looks confusing,
Jesus,
and I don't know which way to go,
you
Lord,
are
you remain the center,
center,
the center of my joy,
of my
sing
joy,
Jesus, from my heart to the heavens,
you
Lord,
are
you be the center,
the center,
the center of my
of
joy,
my
Lord,
joy,
Lord, you are my strength. Lord, from you is
you
where
are
I and in you
the
is where
center.
I found you're the center of my
joy.
Jesus, Lord,
you are
the
center.
And we love you.
Of
we
my
you.
Joy,
we
my Jesus.
We are so grateful.
You are
you really
the
are center.
Center.
You're the center of my
of
joy.
My
say,
joy,
Jesus.
Jesus.
You are the center of my
of
joy.
My joy.
Jesus. Yeah, Lord,
you are the center of my joy.
You're the center of my joy. Oh, yes, you are. Everything I need, I find in you. Somebody say my joy.
My joy.
Happy Sabbath, everyone, and happy anniversary to Toronto Perth. My name is Eddie Kerwan. I am the son of Keith Kerwan and Perlene Kerwan. I have two children, Rhea and Kyan Kerwan, and then married to my beautiful wife, Janice Kerwan.
We thought it would be easy to give you some of our fond memories of Toronto Perth, but it was quite a challenge because there's so many. So we decided to give you our top 10 memories growing up in Toronto Perth.
Number 10. Going to camp meeting as a child with my mother, eating lunch, picking strawberries. One year at camp meeting, as I remember, there was a ravine near Kingsway College, near the tent where we worshiped. And at the top of the ravine, there were crab apples, the bottom of the ravine, there were crab apples. And all the young people gathered together that evening. And it was a crab apple war, I would per se, and it was crab apples everywhere. But I would never forget that Sabbath evening after sunset when we had this crab apple war. Also, as children, we didn't have cell phones. So in order for us to communicate with our friends in church, we would write notes. We would tear the bulletin off and we'd write detailed notes and we'd send it across. And it would go through about six or seven of our friends' hands before it got to the other destination, and then it would return back. But nobody read the messages in between. Also, number eight, one Sabbath evening when church let out, if you remember, the church basement had a stage and the front of the stage would pull out. So when church let out, they pulled that stage and a bat flew out. And if you can remember this Sabbath evening when everybody just cleared the center of the basement and pinned to the sides with broom, trying to wave the bat out. It was a spectacle that Sabbath afternoon when church let out. But that was another one of my fond memories at Perth.
Number seven, changing right after AY and getting ready for those social events.
Remembering gym night, leaving Perth and heading out to skating, basketball. Those gym nights were very special. Also, I remember playing basketball outside the men's washroom. There would be a pole and we would play every Sabbath afternoon, dunking the pole, and we would hear all of the elders, "Don't dunk on the pole." And it was Sabbath after Sabbath, but we had fun at that time. As a child, I also remember number six, I think I'm at. As a child, I remember my mom taking me to many, many events, Florida, trips to the church. There was countless trips to the church I remember going on. Also, my mom would be part of a group called, tag me along to her action team meetings. She would tag me along to Maranatha. I also remember in gathering, we would have these containers with slots and we would go around Perth and the whole neighborhood and we'd fill up our in gathering tins and we would leave tracks to the neighbors in the neighborhood. And I also remember that very fond moment as well.
Number five, Brother Stennett, the enforcer. Brother Stennett always wore his belt off to the side. Not sure why he did that, but he did. He would always come to the basement to scan any young person that was there and be ready to tell them, "It's time to go upstairs. AY started.
Upstairs, upstairs."
Yes, yes, just like that. Or, "It's divine worship time," and we would just follow. But one day, someone asked him a question, and he wasn't expecting it, so he just smiled. And just to show you the warmth, so he wasn't just an enforcer, but behind that, he was warm.
Nice smile.
He smiled.
He yelled at you and had such a nice smile.
Yes, and so you would probably be afraid of him if you didn't know him, but he was warm. He was warm. So number five, Brother Stennett.
Number five, Brother Stennett, and the belt. I'm gonna have to find out why the reason that belt was off to the side. I don't know. Okay. Number four, Pathfinders. There's enough in there on its own memories to last me a lifetime. It's one part in life that I'm happy that I've went through. And also, track and field, Apple Creek versus Perth. The consistent battles growing up, we went hard in track and field for those titles, but we'll always remember those memories as well. Toronto Perth Panthers.
Number three.
I want to say thank you to my spiritual mothers, who I spent a lot of time with over the years as a child. I want to thank Sister Grace Glasgow. I want to thank Sister Scantaberry. I want to thank Sister Griffin. I want to express another special thank to Sister Mackenzie. And
Sister Kate.
And Sister Mama Tate.
Sister Kate.
The House of Love.
The House of Love.
To your stomach, your mind, your soul.
How could we forget Sister Tate? Every Sabbath at Sister Tate's house was just a gathering to remember. It was all of us young people there. She would welcome us every Sabbath in her home.
No place like home.
No place like home. And also, I would like to thank my aunt, Sister Matrigal White. When I came to Perth, I came with my aunt, and if I wasn't at my aunt's, I was at one of these moms. So I want to just thank my aunt and all these beautiful ladies as well for taking us under their wings. Number two, Sister Casimir, and again Sister Griffin, Antonavis. Sister Casimir and Antonavis were both our Sabbath school teachers. These ladies taught us about God. They showed us how to emulate God's character just by their actions. Thank you. And finally, number one.
Perth has given me a lot of memories, but one memory I will never forget is the day I met my beautiful wife at Perth. So I'm happy for all that I've given to Perth. I'm happy for everything that Perth has given to me and my family and for our community. And I wish Perth all the best in 50 more years, that it will be this prosperous and many more memories to come. And I want to thank you all for joining us in our 50th anniversary special.
Toronto Perth has definitely impacted our life, and this church has kept us grounded in our relationship with God, gave us friends that reminded us of Christ. The church family has taught us how to love, showed us warmth, kindness, and we want to say thank you, Toronto Perth.
Thank you, Toronto Perth.
As we continue our 50th anniversary celebrations, we are privileged this afternoon to have Pastor Frankie Lazarus, one of the former pastors of the Toronto Perth Church, as our speaker. This year, Pastor Lazarus celebrates 36 years in the gospel ministry. During this time, he has spread himself in several areas of the Lord's work. Pastor Lazarus has served as campus chaplain at the Crawford Adventist Academy, as youth pastor, and lead pastor in several churches throughout the Ontario Conference. He has also served as an administrator for youth ministries in the Ontario Conference, as well as a facilitator for youth ministries for the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Canada. Pastor Lazarus has traveled extensively in such places as Canada, the United States, Central America, the United Kingdom, and the Caribbean as a featured speaker for evangelism and youth ministries. He is admired, revered, and loved as an enthusiastic advocate for young people. Both his academic degrees, the Bachelor of Theology and the Master of Divinity are from Andrews University. He and his wife Sharon are blessed to have two adult children who are growing successful professionals. I am very happy to introduce a colleague of mine, a friend of mine, one who mentors me. Yes, Pastor Lazarus mentors me. He is the coordinator for the Metro West region of pastors and churches right here in Toronto. And I'm telling you that Pastor Lazarus provides capable leadership. He's a model pastor and one that all of us look to for continued leadership. Pastor Lazarus, it is my pleasure to be associated with you, and I am sure that God will use you in the usual manner, the anointed manner, to bring through you a message for the people of God on this occasion. Immediately after this special item of music, we will hear from God's man, my personal friend, my colleague, my mentor, and a servant of the Lord, Pastor Frankie Lazarus.
When they heard a mighty multitude was quickly drawing near. But as they prayed for deliverance, the victory would begin. For when we call upon the Lord, we summon all of heaven. Pray on, for you are who the Lord. What would be in store? But when we stand on holy ground, our smallest prayer is heard. Instead of on our circumstance, our eyes are on the Lord. Pray on, for you are who the Lord is looking for. Pray. They don't seem to make a change. Just rest assured, God knows your needs, and He hears each time you pray. Your prayers are reaching heaven, and the answer's on the way. For this is where the battle is won.
afternoon. It is my privilege, pleasure, delight to be here with you this afternoon as we continue our celebration of the 50th anniversary of the Toronto Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church. And some of you may not know why we always say Toronto Perth. And the reason for that is there is a Perth in Ontario that has a church. So we are quite distinctive in saying Toronto Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church. A time like this brings back memories for me. I have literally grown up with the Toronto Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church. As an 11-year-old, and I guess I can see all the mathematicians now, they'll start working. As an 11-year-old, I was at Toronto West with my family, with my father, when Elder Parchment Sr. Began the process of establishing the church plant that would be known as Toronto Perth, just up the road from the Harvey Street Church. And it was exciting days as we prepared this old church building for this new venture, this new church. The Harvey Street had grown and it was time to divide, and Toronto Perth became the baby of this strong Caribbean congregation. So it was an exciting time. And then we moved out east. My family moved out to the east end. But Toronto Perth grew to such a strong church that on Sabbath afternoons, most people found their way down to one of two churches, Toronto Perth or Toronto Harvey Street. Those were great days as a child growing up in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Toronto Perth became one of the powerhouses of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Ontario. And my recollection is mainly with Pathfinders, strong Pathfinder ministry and strong youth ministry. And I'm going to be very careful this afternoon as I think about my topic for this afternoon, which is keep fighting, keep on running, keep the faith. Toronto Perth became this strong, dynamic, vibrant church. You have had great leaders come through this church, great lay leaders as well as pastoral leadership. You've had some really good pastoral leadership come through this church. I remember hearing stories of the great Pastor Rick Backus, who did some things that I sort of took on just because of what I heard, and then you had some fantastic evangelistic services come through here, and then I had the opportunity of working with Pastor Steve Cassamy, Dr. Steve Cassamy, as someone who has been a stalwart for this congregation, somebody who has meant much to this congregation. And I promised myself I wouldn't call names, because you know when you start calling names, people start to listen for their name. And then when their name doesn't get called, you know, you get a phone call, you know. I happen to be one of the few pastors in this conference who had their ordination at their home church. And I will never forget that Sabbath afternoon when the young people came together and gave a celebration of my ordination. I will never forget that. I don't know how I got to be so fortunate. Most people will say, okay, at the camp meeting, that's the greatest thing. But I felt it was just so intimate, so real, so personal, because of the relationships that were being developed in Toronto Perth, relationships that I still have today with individuals. Whenever I meet them, whenever I see them, it's just a warm feeling in my heart to remember the joy of serving at Toronto Perth. You know, and as I said, I'm not going to call names because you know people will. You know, I'll never forget starting the rumor about a certain couple And the rumor was that they were having a baby. And I just did that. It was a lark. And the next Sabbath, I showed up in church and somebody said, I'm not calling any names, do you know that such and such a person is pregnant? And I said, what? They're pregnant? What do you mean they're pregnant? Well, the rumor had gotten around. Just to show you, when you want to tell, when you want to get past the message, tell an Adventist. And they will be quick to pass the message along. The relationships were just amazing here. Any pastor who comes to Toronto Perth, any pastor, and I think it's the same thing now, and Pastor Williams might be able to attest, but any pastor or associate or assistant, you will work when you come to Toronto Perth. You will work, because Toronto Perth is a hard-working church, and that's something I remember much about Toronto Perth. Another thing I remember about Toronto Perth is not this building. I've never been in this building, never been in this area, but I was at the old building downtown, and that building was special. The basement was amazing. That basement was a living space. From 8 o'clock in the morning till 11, 12 o'clock at night, it was a living space. There was a social, it seemed like there was a social every single Saturday evening. There was a social. It was beautiful. Dominoes in one room, and it was serious dominoes. Don't mess around with the domino players in their little room. Young people in another room, and the cooking in the kitchen, that small kitchen, put through some food. I mean, it was amazing. It was amazing. Saturday evenings were just special. The youth choir. I will never forget the youth choir. They have a special place in my heart. I've told you in my recollections already that the song, The Potter's House, has only been preached once and never again, because I don't have another youth choir that can do it just like the youth choir back then. And I tried it with another choir, and they're still waiting for me to come back and say, let's preach the sermon. I asked them to practice. I went and listened and said, they can't do it. I cannot duplicate what took place that Sabbath morning with the Potter's House. I don't know how many of you remember the night, the AY that I cried. I don't forget that AY that I cried. Dr. Casimir had left. He'd gone on some preaching assignment, and I was the pastor of the day. I was the one in charge, and there was an AY program going on, and the young people, they were playing the drums, and it upset some people. That's one thing about Toronto Perth. When you upset people, they'll let you know. They will not let you know that they're upset, and they let the young people know they were upset, and I took it personally that they were upset, and I cried in front of everybody for the young people, because I loved the young people so much. And then I said I wasn't going to call any names, but I'm going to call a name, because one of my fondest memories, persons who's no longer with us, is Brother Stennett. And I hope that somehow during this time you all can give some recognition to Brother Stennett. Brother Stennett was the guy. I remember some really tough discussions with Brother Stennett. He was the soldier of the Toronto Perth Church. He loved the church. He was the head deacon, and he just kept things in place. So my memories are very fond. When I was asked to come and present, to talk to you, to present, I just wanted to reflect from the heart. What do you say, having grown up with the Toronto Perth Church as part of your environment, from an 11-year-old when they were starting, and now having been an associate pastor for a short while with one of the premier pastors of this church, a pastor who has been loved. What do you come and say to people and to individuals at their 50th? Think about it. You have been around for 50 years. 50 years. Toronto Perth has been in existence. You know, it's quite easy to become a church. And I say that carefully. It's quite easy to become a church. Relatively easy, I should say. But being a church in a hostile, alien world is where the battle is. Being a church which is filled with people of differing backgrounds, differing ideas and ideals, differing ways of doing things and looking at things, and maintaining that steady, consistent force for good is where it really gets interesting, is where the battle is. Being a church when there are external forces and pressures that come upon you, that are impressed upon you. Being a church when there are internal conflicts, and you have been through your conflicts. You have been through your difficult moments, your moments when I'm quite certain some of you would have had misgivings about what was going on. Being a church when people's personal battles get brought into the body. Being a church when there are interpersonal conflicts, church boards, business meetings, even just regular meetings down in the basement or in the fellowship hall. And then being a church when the devil has his mighty opposition against the work that you're doing in the community with his mighty temptations, the real test of your faith is to survive for 50 years with all these pressures and maintain your identity and your integrity and your vibrancy and your commitment to the cause. That says something. That really says something. You see, being a church is not a 100-yard dash, but it's a marathon. It is having the capacity to stick to it. Having the capacity that despite the struggles, despite the difficulties, despite the obstacles, the mountains and the valleys, the rivers and the lakes that you must cross, you will stick to it. There is a mission that you must accomplish, and you will not give up until the mission is accomplished. And so, in my text, the text that was read for scripture reading, we have the Apostle Paul. Permit me to just read it again from the New King James Version, 2 Timothy 4, verse 6 through 8. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. I'm using this text I'm taking some license with this text, and I'm using it because we have Paul here coming towards the end of his life, and he knows that it's his time is at hand, and he's looking at death in the face, and he is writing a letter to Timothy. It seems that Timothy is his mentee. And he's giving words of encouragement to Timothy. It's interesting when you read the whole book. It's Timothy, do this. Timothy, think about this. Timothy, watch out for this challenge. Timothy, stand. Timothy, go forward. Timothy, be instant, in season, out of season. Timothy, preach the word. But then he changes from speaking to Timothy to talking about himself in the first person. I am already being poured out as a drink. One might think that Paul is in the midst of discouragement, but I want to suggest to you that even though he is sitting in prison, in a dank, damp, dark prison, even though he's sitting there and he knows that his time is coming to an end, it seems to me his very use of the metaphor that I am being poured out as a drink offering indicates to me that there is a note of victory in his voice. that he's getting ready to say something, and something to us living in the 21st century. He's going to say something that has victory in it, because to be poured out as a drink offering was a reference back to the sacrificial system, where wine would be poured out with the various offerings. And as the wine is poured out onto the offering, there would be a hiss and a smoke would rise up, and it would become as a sweet smelling savor unto the Lord. And it's interesting, when the Lord instituted this particular part of the sacrifices, he said to them, you're not going to do this in the desert. You're only going to do this in the promised land. So it was when they got to the promised land that the ritual of pouring out a drink offering came to being. It seemed to me that what Paul is trying to do here is he's trying to relate to the fact that as he looked over his life, he could look back at his life and think about nothing but victory. I am being poured out as a drink offering. I am being poured out as an offering. My life, when you look back over my life, it is as an offering. I love how the Message Bible puts the life of Paul, where it says in 2 Corinthians, verse 11, and I'm reading from the Message Bible. I can't believe I'm saying these things. I'm starting from verse 22. I can't believe I'm saying these things. It's crazy to talk this way. But I started, and I'm going to finish. I've worked much harder, been jailed more often, beaten up more times than I can count, and at death's door time after time, I've been flogged 5 times, with the Jews, 39 lashes, beaten by Roman rods 3 times, pummeled with rocks once. I've been shipwrecked 3 times and immersed in the open sea for a night and a day. In hard traveling year in and year out, I've had to ford rivers, fend off robbers, struggle with friends, struggle with foes. I've been at risk in the city, at risk in the country, endangered by desert sun and sea storm, and betrayed by those I thought were my brothers. I've known drudgery and hard labor, many a long and lonely night without sleep, many a missed meal, blasted by the cold, naked to the weather. And yet, at this very same time, as we read these words, that Paul is coming towards the end of his life, it is not the words of a discouraged, broken old man. There is no despair, no defeat, no cynicism, no fear, as he faces his imminent execution when his head will be lopped off. No. What we have here is a man who is relishing in the victory that comes from serving God. And I hope that you here this evening, as you celebrate over the next few months, as you celebrate, will relish in the victory that God has given you at the Toronto Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church. Not from a braggadocious point of view where you're saying, look at me, but you're from a point of view where you're saying, praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, we have gone into the teeth of the enemy, and we have come out victorious. We have arrived and we have made it to this point, and we are in the point of transitioning now. So we can say, the older folks can say to the young people, we have fought the good fight. We stayed in the fight. We stayed in the battle. Do not give up. Our legacy should be your success. Our legacy should be you taking up the mantle and saying, we will do just as you did when we had to fight racism, when we had to fight community objections, when we had to fight the difficulties of depression and discouragement, when we had to fight people leaving and moving and going places because they had moved on. We still stood strong. We have fought the good fight. Paul is looking at his life and he's saying to this young Timothy, I have fought the good fight. I've stayed in the fight. There is nothing worse. And as a teenager growing up in England, fighting was a part of my existence. And it was a part of my existence just because, you know, racism. You had to stand up for yourself. And I'll never forget one day coming home and something happened to my sisters. And the question my mother asked was, where was your brother? Where was your brother? And of course I wasn't around, and I had to answer for why I was not around to protect my sisters. Because sometimes you do have to fight. Sometimes to be successful, you've got to wrestle. Sometimes to get to the other side, you have to put your fist up and say, we're not going to take this lying down. Sometimes you have to stand up to the bully. Sometimes you have to go up in the face of individuals that you know mean you no good and say to them, we will not. And I want to put it to you today, young people, and to my Christian friends, that the reason why we are here today is because we stand on the shoulders of members in your church who went into the battle and fought the fight on your behalf so you could become the church that you are today. I fought the good fight. And then Paul says, I have finished the course. I have finished the course, you know. Going back to my childhood days again, I could run the 100-yard dash. I was pretty good. Take my word for it. Don't doubt me. It's the truth. But what I couldn't do was the cross-country. What I couldn't do was the cross-country. Because you can get out nice and strong, but if you don't plan the race properly, by the time you get one third of the race, one quarter of the race, you're spent. And you're gonna take shortcuts and things like that. No, when you're in this Christian battle, you've got to be in it for the long run. And there are going to be obstructions. There are going to be obstacles. There are going to be difficulties. But you have to stay on the course. You can't look for the easy way out because there are no easy way outs. You can't look for the less difficult road because the less difficult road still has its issues. You can't look for the greener pastures because the greener pastures have their own dry patches also. You have to stick to the course. Stay on course. And so as we think about the last 50 years, as we celebrate the past, let's embrace the future that despite the difficulties, because of the lessons learned in the past, we can stay on course for the future. We can stay in the moment. We can stay in our time. We can be what God has called us to be. You see, Paul wanted Timothy to finish, and he wanted Timothy to finish well. Finish well, because God wants us to finish well. And the beautiful thing about serving God is that where we are weak, he is strong, and he can make up the difference for us. You see, in finishing the course, we're saying that our present is just going to be okay. And then he continues, my past, I have fought the good fight. My present, I have finished the course. Henceforth. Henceforth what? Henceforth. No, I have kept the faith. I apologize. I have kept the faith. Henceforth. There is a crown laid up for me. Can I suggest to you today, as you celebrate 50 years, that this is not the reward. No, it's not the reward. Henceforth, there is laid up a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me. There are some people who've fallen by the wayside. There are some people who have given up. There are some people who have queried and are concerned about what it is where we are doing here. But I want to suggest to you that if you focus too much on yourself, you will lose sight of the goal. If you focus too much on your difficulty and your struggle, you will lose sight of the goal. Because as I was saying to somebody this morning, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, but he has washed me white as snow. Jesus Christ has gained the victory for on my behalf. All I have to do is keep my faith in him. And if I keep my faith in Jesus, he has promised me there is a crown laid up for me on that great day. It means that the stuff I have to go through in this moment, in staying the course, in fighting the fight, in keeping the faith, the stuff I have to go through one day, he will say to me, my child, well done. Come now, enter into that which I have prepared for you. There's a story that I like to tell as we bring this to a close. It's a true story. In fact, many of you know the story. It is the story of the Toronto Raptors. How for many, many, many years, many, many, many years, they desired to win the NBA championship. And then they found themselves a savior named Kawhi. And Kawhi would take them to the promised land. The organization put all the chips in and said, it's on you, Kawhi. And we will never forget, we collectively, even though we're not here together, we will never forget game 7 of Philadelphia versus Toronto. Game 7 has been the nemesis of the Toronto Raptors. We can go back to several game 7s when one shot was the difference. One shot was the difference. And so for the basketball players, and I've promised never to call names, but I often think about Mouse, and I think about my good friend. I think about Mouse, and I forget that night. They're down. Kawhi receives the ball. And Kawhi goes, where does he go? He goes right. He goes right. He goes right. He goes right. He turns, pops the shot, and the ball goes up and it bounces once, twice, three times, four times, and then into the basket. And the life of a nation was changed. And the nation said, oh, what a nice shot. We win. Now, you know that didn't happen like that. You know that I know that. Kawhi goes around. He shoots. Does a little squat. One, two, three. Watch the TV. Watch the replay of this. One, two, three. The nation holds its breath because will it be another moment of disappointment? Will it be another moment when the fight has been lost? Will it be another moment when the race has been taken away from us? Will it be another moment when our faith will be destroyed? Because we are not Leafs fans. We are Raptors fans. Will it be a moment when our faith is destroyed and it goes in one last time? And you watch the picture, watch the replay, and the whole stadium erupts in joy and celebration and magnificent exaltation. And outside in Raptor Land, whatever they call that place, there is massive pandemonium. And across the nation, there is an eruption of joy and elation. And in my house, there is a lady that jumps up as though she's going to hit the roof because now it has happened at last. We get into the finals. We didn't win anything yet, but we have gotten into the finals. I want to suggest to you, my Christian friends, that when you fight the good fight, when you finish the course, when you keep the faith, there is joy in heaven. There is joy in the universe because you have done what God said you could do, and all you had to do was trust him. He says there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And if you are in Christ Jesus, victory is yours. Fight the fight. Run the race. Keep the faith. There's a crown for you. And 50 years is nothing compared to eternity with Jesus Christ. For we shall live with him forever and ever and ever and ever. And forever is a long, long time. Divide that by 50 and you still can't get there. To God be the glory. Great things he has done.
What a powerful word. Wow. 50 years of praise, faith, and family. Hi, everyone. I am Emma Griffin Brown, and I am a proud Toronto Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church baby. I have so many memories when it comes to this church. Church socials, AY programs, church picnic, divine service. But the one thing that encompasses all those things is that the Holy Spirit was in the midst. As we look back at the 80s, we also thank God for our present and for our future. We know that God is able to do immeasurably above all that we ask. Before I have our closing prayer, I'd like to thank the participants, those who said yes to this program. First, I'd like to thank my wonderful mother, Sister Mavis Griffin, who served as an AY leader in the 80s and the 90s. The Morris family, Ashanti Maygott, Javanna Bailey, Connie Page, Eddie and Janice Kerwin, Nadine Stennett Thomas. I'd also like to thank Nashana Hilton for putting all of these pieces together, Sister Broomfield and the 50th Anniversary Committee. And I'd also like to thank Pastor Lazarus for, again, that very powerful message. Although we are virtual, we know that the Holy Spirit is in the midst, and he is doing great things in our lives. So at this time, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we want to thank you so much for allowing us to come together as a family. We thank you for allowing us to celebrate these 50 years. And for us to look back at the 80s. But Lord, we also like to thank you for our present and our future, dear God. We are entrusting and know that our lives are in your hands, and we thank you for that. Lord, we want to thank you for every participant, for those that are watching at home. We ask that you please be with each home and each family, be with their health. Strengthen them, encourage them as we enter into this new week. And Lord, help us to continue to encourage and to pray for one another until we get to see each other face to face. Lord, we thank you and we love you. Thank you for this ministry and for loving us unconditionally. These things we beseech and ask thee. Amen.
On behalf of the pastoral team and the anniversary committee here at the Toronto Perth Seventh-day Adventist Church, we would like to thank you for worshiping with us today. Before you go, don't forget to like this video, subscribe to our channel, and click the notification bell so that you can be notified every time we post another video. We hope to see you back here on August 4th for our Zoom Sabbath School program at 9 a.m. and our Divine Service program at 11 a.m., where we will be highlighting the 90s era in our history. As we depart and you navigate this new week, may the Lord bless and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he give you peace in your going out and in your coming in your lying down and in your rising up, in your labor and in your leisure, in your laughter and in your tears. Have a happy Sabbath, and may God continue to richly bless you. Bye.